tuning in to the online broadcast network, AFTERBUZZ TV. Over 20 million weekly downloads in over 150 countries and your number one source for after-show entertainment. AFTERBUZZ TV, the destination for TV superfans. Producing aftershows for over 300 of your favorite TV shows. Interviewing celebrities and showrunners. And bringing you behind-the-scenes exclusives. All thanks to E! Entertainment's Maria Menounos, producer Kevin Undergaro, and internet leader Akamai. Now, let the buzz begin!
Hello, AfterBuzz fans of The Flash. We are here with a very, very special episode for you. But I want to introduce my co-host before we start. This is Jeff Masters.
Hello, hello.
I'm Roxy Striar, and we have the most amazing guest for you tonight. Danielle Panabaker has joined us in studio.
Hi, guys.
We are so excited to have you here. I can't believe you got to come in. I mean, I never thought we would see Caitlin Snowkiller Frost sitting in our studio with us.
I'm so happy to be here.
Good. Okay, so let's get right into The Flash, which is my number one favorite show.
Oh,
obsessed with it. We cover the after show together.
Yeah, we love it.
So fun. Thanks, guys. I love that.
And your character is amazing.
She's the best. I feel so lucky. You know, she's such a smart woman, and I feel like that's sort of rare. It's changing, you know, with the times, but, she's got her own point of view. She's got her own history, and she's not just sort of following along the boys all the time. She's got her own
How
agenda.
Quickly did you learn that about her? How quickly did you fall in love with the character?
You know what? I think in doing the pilot, I was just sort of taking everything in and learning everything about the world and the show and what they were doing. But, you know, as the episodes started to come through, it became so clear that our writers love her so much and have such respect for her. And it really just helped me to love her, too.
Yeah. Was that like working on a character where there's like so much backstory versus just like one scene that you know about?
You know, I feel like there's not a ton. It's not overwhelming. Okay. I feel like Grant as the Flash, like, that's overwhelming. There's so many versions.
Right.
Like,
yeah.
How do you keep up? But for me, yes, it exists. But I also choose to sort of focus on the story we're telling for the TV show rather than the whole, you know, DC mythology, if that makes sense.
It completely makes sense. I'm wondering how involved you were in the DCU before the show. Are you somebody who's been a comic book fan before, or you kind of just appreciated it, but you didn't read them and you were excited to learn more about it?
I'm very new to the comic book world. You know, I have a younger sister, so with us, it was like dance class. There wasn't a lot of comics in our life. So, I'm truly getting the best education possible. Jeff Johns, who is one of the co-creators of our show, is, you know, a king at DC as far as I'm concerned.
And he's a king here, too. We love him.
He's the best. So to have him sort of shepherding my introduction to the whole world I've been very lucky.
I love hearing, like, Jeff and, like, Greg Berlanti just talk about, like, growing up with these characters.
Oh, they love them. Yeah. And Greg especially loves The Flash. Like, this is truly a dream come true for him
to
see it brought to life. Yeah.
It must make you feel really comfortable then, like you're in very good hands.
Absolutely. I mean, they care so much, which means everybody else cares. Like, they're so invested in telling a great story, and it inspires us to want to tell a great story, too.
You said you're a dancer, and I'm wondering, so we have this kind of elephant in the room with your character.
Okay.
And right now, you're one thing, but we think you might turn into something else.
We have to say it.
I'm trying to be
maybe
around the bush.
A spoiler, in the comic book, she becomes Killer Frost.
Yes.
Right. It's not a secret.
Yeah.
No, it's not a secret. I mean, that was sort of announced when they sort of started the idea of the pilot and that sort of thing. They teased it a little bit.
But I'm wondering if you do become Killer Frost, I think that dance background will probably help you a lot because there's going to be more fighting, I'm assuming, and more choreography for what you have to do.
I would assume. I mean, the most I can speak to is Grant's dance background because he's an incredible dancer. I mean,
he's an incredible everything.
Yeah. But, like, truthfully, he like, dances in between setups and that sort of thing. Like, it's in his nature. It's in his blood.
Cool.
And it's really funny to see him do the stunt stuff, because he has the statue of a dancer and, like, the presence of it. So it's really cool. And I think it certainly helped him.
Wow.
So. Also, the Killer Frost costume, though, it's, like, so otherworldly.
Yes,
so that would be cool to see, like, how they make that on the
TV
show.
Yeah, I'm excited. I think it's going to be really cool. Yeah.
Is it something, I don't know if you can answer this, but is it something we can, like, look forward to, like, this season, eventually, like...
About Killer Frost?
Yeah.
I would say Killer Frost sort of falls... under the eventually
long-term plan.
Yeah, it's a long-term plan.
Cool.
But I will also tease that you might get a peek at her sooner rather than later.
Oh, very cool.
I can't be any more specific than that.
I think that's just so exciting because, like, Killer Frost and Cisco becomes Vibe. Mm-hmm. There's so many, like, potential superheroes when right now we just have The Flash. Like, that's a lot of series regulars being superheroes.
Yes, which is why I think we'll take it one at a time. Right now it's just The Flash.
An overdose.
We're still learning so much about him and his capabilities and that sort of thing.
I think it's interesting that you made that point, though, Jeff, because yes, we are seeing a lot of heroes if all of these come true, but your character has been known to be more of a villain. Yes. But on the show, you are absolutely the hero, and you are always sticking up for Barry. So I'm wondering, is it possible that we're going to see a different version of Killer Frost, or how could that work out? Because I know they're being so loyal to the comics.
They are being very loyal to the comics. You know, I think it'll just be interesting to see Caitlin's journey. Already this season, we're starting to see more and more of it, just in terms of her, you know, dealing with the death of her fiancé, and as we found out in last week's episode, he's not actually dead. So you have to, you know, we're going to go on Caitlin's journey with that and see where it takes her.
Let's talk about that journey for
a
second. So before we see that journey, I've got to say, Twitter is blowing up about you and Barry romance.
Oh, the Snowberry, yes.
Oh, my God, the Snowberry.
Yes.
Oh, I haven't heard that before.
I'm new to it all, too. This shipping thing a new thing for me.
I know. I feel a little aged sometimes when I talk, because my little sister had to teach me what shipping was, and I was like, oh, I'm confused. But people ship you guys. They ship the Snowberry. And I'm wondering, it must be really hard for you, as I'm sure you're a fan of the show and you're also in it. Could you see your character being romantically involved with Barry, even though you know that your fiancé is coming back?
I think that they're really good friends, and they really have connected on a special level. I mean, you know, there have been scenes that we have shot that actually haven't made it into a final cut because they're trying to slow the roll on that one a little bit. Mm-hmm. So I think right now they're just friends, and I think they sort of can relate on this element of being in love with someone that they can't be with. You know, Barry's in love with Iris. She's got another boyfriend. Caitlin's in love with Ronnie. She thinks he's dead, but maybe he's not. So they can bond on that level right now.
And they both have lost very important people in their lives together.
Absolutely. So right now I think it's their coworkers and their friends. And
how often does that happen where you're recording scenes that don't make it into the show? And how do you as an actress deal with knowing, having that knowledge, but not bringing that to your character yet? Because we don't have that knowledge.
On our show, we shoot a lot. I mean, our scripts are long, we shoot a lot of material, and sometimes stuff doesn't make it. And I think it's always because they have a bigger plan, you know, specifically in regards to some of the stuff between myself and Grant that had been cut out. It was because they wanted to do a better version of it in episode 12.
Oh, wow.
You know what I mean? So it's an evolving process. So it is a little bit of a challenge when, like, fortunately, they've been really good about saying, FYI, that scene is not in that episode.
Yeah.
So don't talk about it. So they've been helpful in that sense. And, you know, we just trust them that they're going to tell the story the right way.
That's nice to have the ability, too, to make that decision. It's not just like, we shot it, we have to air it.
Oh, yeah. I think our cuts are only, an episode of television is only supposed to be like 44 minutes long. Mm-hmm. And episode 109, I think in the original cut, was over an hour long. We had so much footage for it. So they obviously have to condense it and, you know, pick the best stuff to tell.
Do you get to see all that footage?
No.
Oh, my gosh. That's just in the can.
It is. It exists out there. And, you know, maybe it'll be on a DVD someday.
How do you watch the episodes? Do you watch the episodes, or is it hard to watch?
It's hard to watch myself, but I do watch them, especially because it's a new show and I'm still learning so much about the way the show looks and, you know, different things like that. Because, you know, I'm sure you guys have experienced this. What you see in front of you is not always what shows up on camera.
Right.
So I like to watch the shows. Unfortunately, most of the time we're working when they air live. So I will try and watch them on, you know, when the next time I have an hour in my trailer or that sort of thing.
Yeah.
We try and watch it as quickly as possible.
So speaking about working when they're live, it seems like you're working all of the time.
It does.
Of the time. Which is why when Jeff and I were talking about before, how on earth did you manage to film both the Flash and the crossover? I mean, you're filming two episodes. Where is there time in the day for that?
I mean, you know, that's the best analogy I can, the best analogy I can give is that it's like having two full-time jobs. It's like we already had a full-time job on The Flash, and on top of that, so basically what it meant is, you know, we would start in the morning on Flash, and you'd go to Arrow in the afternoon, and we would just, you know, truth be told, by the last Friday, because it was over probably a three-week period that we were doing both of the crossovers, wow. First them coming to us and then us going to them, there was one Friday night where we were in the Foundry until 6 or 7 o'clock on Saturday morning. Like, we started at 4 on Friday afternoon, and you just work and work and work until you can get everything done. So,
what keeps you going in those times? I mean, how
I
do you...
I have no idea.
and what misses is just sleep. No sleep.
Yeah, you know, you don't get sleep, or you get really good at cat naps. I could just, you know. But of course, hair is like, don't lay down on your hair. Makeup's like, don't lay down on your face. So you sort of like figure out your way to handle it and just take a little cat nap here and there.
So you can sleep standing now. Is what you're telling
me. I mean, I'm a pretty good sleeper. By the way, my boyfriend says that all the time. If I have a superpower, it's sleeping. I can sleep anywhere. I can sleep so long.
We
it's
know. We talk to him.
Yeah.
Lucky
give me
for
inside
you.
Scoop. Yeah.
Right.
I want to know about your experience because we just saw the crossover. I thought that it was some of the best episodes of television I've ever seen. I thought they were unbelievable.
I love them, yeah.
Oh, thanks.
And coming, I was a big Arrow fan. I still mm-hmm. am. And so getting to see those universes merge was really exciting for me.
And the tones of the shows, too.
Right. Yeah, because they are so different. You know, we always, from the get-go, used to joke that, you know, Steven's character would walk into Star Labs and be like, wow, it's so bright in here. You know what I mean?
And they kind of said that on the show.
So, you know... It was great. We're very lucky. The director who directed episode 108 for us is a guy named Glenn Winter, who came from Arrow originally. So he knows all of those actors really well, and he knows this world so well. So he was a great person to sort of shepherd us into the crossovers. And then, you know, from there, we are, as actors, we feel like we know our characters very well and are protective of them, and they write for us quite well. So really... It was play. It was really fun.
We've read that there's a big difference between the way that they film their show and the way you film yours based on that bright and sunny place mm-hmm. and that really dark place. Did you notice that difference on set? Did it affect the vibe there?
I don't know if it affected the vibe. I'm such a klutz and a spaz. Like, every time I'd walk onto the Arrow stage, I'd be like, oh my God, I need a flashlight. Like, I can't see where I'm going. So it is darker there and, you know, versus being on our show, which is very bright and Star Labs is big and open. And, you know, the Foundry is dark and it's a lair and right. smoky and all those things. So,
what's it like shooting every week with a new villain and then, like, having to deal with those, like, special effects? Because they all are, like, very different.
They are very different. And truthfully, I have so much respect for our special effects team and what they do every week, because that's what's really cool for me getting to watch the show, is what we shoot is oftentimes so different than what actually ends up on television. You know, we're reacting to a guy turning into metal, but it's really Greg just standing there looking scary. And, you know, you use your imagination, and sometimes how I imagine it isn't necessarily how it shows up on screen. It's oftentimes better. Like, The Mist, I thought, looked amazing. And, of course, you know, he's not disappearing in front of our eyes. Right. All of that is done later. So, it's cool.
Does your background in horror help you with that a little bit? Because I feel like another place that special effects really matter is in horror movies. And so coming from that as an actress, does that help you at all?
I think a little bit. You know, I can't remember who I was having this conversation with recently, but something about how somebody asked if it was hard to work on the green screen, like work with all the green screens and that sort of thing. And for me, it's actually not that much of a challenge because you get to use your imagination versus, and that can go wild versus, you know, the knowledge that just over there, you're no longer on stage and it's just a bunch of C-stands. You know what I mean? Like, you get to really immerse yourself in this imaginary world. So I like working with the green screens and that sort of thing.
All right. Are you able to tell us, every time that Grant, as the Flash, leaves you, your hair blows and the papers are everywhere. Like, are you
and
able
we
to
love it.
By the way, he enters or exits almost every scene. He's, like, always going somewhere.
Right. In a Flash.
Uh-huh. Am I allowed to tell you what? How they do it?
Yes.
Yes. It's, they stand there with a wind machine, but, like, it's a wand, and they spray it at me.
Wait, they spray the wind?
Yes. It's, like, a long, it's connected to... I guess an air can, a big air can, and they use a wand and they spray it at me.
Oh, like a computer cleaner, like a psh of air.
Yes, but like giant, but like 6 feet long, and they spray it at me. We're getting good, you know, because sometimes they'd blow my hair in my lip gloss, and then all of a sudden I have red streaks across my cheek, and that's not good for
anyone. We gotta see bloopers on that.
Oh.
So what's it like being then the only girl in Star Labs? Because we are seeing, you've got all these glam shots, even though you're cool and you're nerdy and you're down with the guy. You're the only girl there, so, and you're gorgeous, of course, so they are always playing that up. What is it like being the only female in what we call the Scooby Gang?
The Scooby Gang? Oh, that's funny. We make jokes about people going, we're going to go be Scooby-Doo and such and such.
Same page.
I love it, to be totally honest. Like, I love all of those guys so much, and they're really great guys, and I have such a, you know, wonderful relationship with all of them. I love talking to Tom about his kids. And Grant is so wonderful and so entertaining. Like, I love it. I feel so lucky. I don't think it ever really occurs to them or anyone that, like, I'm the only girl. I sort of feel like I'm just one of the guys hanging out, you know. Someone and I had a long conversation about bathroom last week on set. I won't tell you who, but, like, you know, I don't think it really occurs to them that much that I'm a girl.
So you're just one of the guys to
them. I think so. I think for the most part. Yeah, sometimes, you know.
Was there ever, like, what kind of, like, was there chemistry reads of any kind? Because we love, like, the group together.
With you and Cisco, especially, yeah. You two play off each other so well.
No, it was really, like, bit by bit.
Really?
Yeah. The project came to me really early in January, and it was such a good fit that I was cast quite quickly. And Grant was already cast, but I think that was it. Grant and maybe Jesse.
You were cast within, like, a week after getting the script?
Yeah.
Wow, that's incredible. Uh-huh.
I had been out of town on Monday. I came back into LA on Tuesday, went straight to the doctor, found out I had strep throat, and still went to meet with everyone because I didn't want to lose the opportunity. And by Friday, I had the role.
Wow. It was really good karma because you were a trooper.
Yeah. Truthfully, I think it was meant to be. Like, it's such a great fit, and I love working with everyone there. So that's been great. And then I think Carlos was actually the only person that they tested for his role. They just knew, which was incredible because... And I don't think he would mind me telling this. He'd never been on camera before this show.
He was a theater actor.
Yeah, a theater actor. So, you know, they'd put him on tape in New York, and everybody saw the tape and was like, oh, my God, he's amazing. So they flew him out, and they tested him by himself, and that was it.
I feel like it really works for his character, though, because all of his... He's such a big guy, and coming from the stage, he's had the ability to do that.
Yeah.
So I feel like you guys all... kind of just were the perfect fit. Is it ever really difficult working with him because he comes from theater?
No, not at all. I actually think our energies are really good in that sense. Like, it's very funny to see, you know, because I feel like Caitlin is pretty composed and put together, and even Kiel. And Cisco's a little bit, like, all over the place, a little bit ADD ideas and stuff. So, I mean, there was a really funny moment. I think it was in 7 where they're talking about Barry going splat in terms of the supersonic punch. And, like, we say the exact same thing, but, you know, his version of splat is very different than Caitlin's version of splat. So it's fun. It's fun to see the two of them play off of each other.
Yeah.
You know what friendship I really like to watch, and I'm hoping we see more if there, because they did hint there might be another crossover at some point. I loved watching you with Felicity.
Yeah. Speaking of shipping, I'm like, that's the best ship I've ever heard. it's great. You know, again, to go back to the thing of, like, being the only girl, like, yes, it was great to have another girl on set.
Yeah.
And she's such a doll and, like, a dog lover, just like I am. So it was great. I would love to see more of that.
Yeah. More of the Felicity. What's your ship name? Do we have a...
Kate-licity, I think. Or something like that.
Why? No.
You could do Flynn or whatever.
I think it sounds perfect.
That's so funny.
So they're filming in Canada while you guys are filming in Canada. Mm-hmm. Do you guys... I know that you just filmed together, but other than that, do you interact much?
We're on the same stages, which is really cool. So, I mean, truthfully, I'll drive into work and see Colton and Emily walking her dog and that sort of thing. We don't necessarily socialize as much as... I wish we did.
Sounds
because
like you don't have time.
Yeah, we're so busy. Like, that's the truth of the matter is, you know, up until recently, we would always shoot until really early Saturday morning. So Saturday's kind of a wash. You're just trying to like sleep and rest up. And then all of a sudden Sunday's here and you've got to prepare for another week.
Oh my God. Can you tell Roxy and everybody what you were telling me earlier about what you've learned about staying warm in Vancouver?
Oh my gosh. So I'm not a cold weather girl at all. Right. I've lived in California for 12 years and being in Vancouver, it's so cold and it's so chilly. And, you know, our wardrobe is what they decide. It's not, you know, I don't get to decide that I'm going to wear a parka in a scene and then that's just the decision. So it all has to be approved. And then it's up to me to find creative ways to stay warm when...
Under the costume.
Yes. So, like, I guess, I think they're for skiing, but, like, there's these little heat packs that you shake up and they make heat. And I am just covered in them. I put them all down my spine. I put them on my shoulders to keep them warm. I put them on my kidneys because that's supposed to keep you warm. I put the little hot shots, the, like, hand warmers in my pockets to keep me warm. Like, oh, if I'm wearing gloves, I put them inside the gloves. Like, I'm shameless about trying to stay as warm as possible.
That's a lot of hand warmers.
Yeah. Is everyone else, like, you guys share tricks? Like, hey, I got a new warm trick for you.
Yes, yeah. And, like, you know, where do you... Like the ones that stick on your feet. Like they have ones that stick on your feet. And I was wearing them on the bottom of my foot. And someone was like, no, you should put them on the top of your foot because they keep you warm longer. So, you know, we're all swapping
stories. I
hadn't thought
about that. Like you're in like short skirts. Cisco's in like, you know, hoodies. They're light looking.
It's a family, though.
It's winter, though.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's winter up there.
So how is it being there? Because you just said you lived in LA for 12 years. Mm-hmm. I mean... I know that it must be an incredible experience filming, but right now we're in LA. I know you're not back here very often.
No.
What's it like being in Canada all the time?
You know, I'm so grateful for the job, and it's such a great gig that I love it. It's definitely a bummer not to be home as much. I like being in LA. This is where my home is. I miss it, but, you know, being up there, we're doing something so cool, and I'm so proud of the show that it's worth it.
Amazing.
Yeah.
How has your fan base been interacting with you? Have they been really receptive of your role and of the show? Are you getting a lot of positive feedback?
It's cool. This isn't my first time being on a show and being on Twitter. I'm still new to Twitter and like social media and all of that. And it's really nice to see the reaction, to see the people interacting when they watch it on Tuesday nights, what they say. You know, it was cute when Barry was sort of mean to Caitlin in the last episode, everybody was like, why didn't he apologize? And it's awesome to see people so invested in it.
They're sticking up for you.
Yeah, it's great.
Wait, so are you aware how like crazy the Twitterverse is trying to figure out who Harrison Wells is?
No, I'm not aware, but I'm not surprised.
Okay.
Oh my gosh, we're going insane.
By the way, theories.
Every time the writers are around, we're pestering them with questions too.
Okay.
Oh my,
we want to know. And truth be told, you know, everything is sort of evolving. I think when we started the pilot, they had one idea, but as we're continuing with the show and they're getting to know each of the actors better, they are, you know, it kind of morphs and evolves into something
else. Oh, that's so interesting. So do you think that we're going to get, like, an answer this season to who he is? Not who
is he,
but
can't we find out?
I mean, I'm excited for you guys to see tomorrow night's episode.
Okay.
That makes three of us. We're so excited for it. It's the mid-season finale.
Yeah, it's a big deal.
We're going to have to let go of you guys for the holiday season.
I know. It's going to be a
long break. Wait, are y'all shooting over the holidays?
We'll be shooting. We take, we're on hiatus for like a week or two, but we need to catch up. It feels like it wasn't that long ago that we shot the crossovers in 109, and, you know, the special effects take a minute. So,
oh, of course.
109 airs tomorrow night, which is a huge episode. And yeah, then there'll be a little hiatus.
All right, we want to get to some questions from your fans that have written into us via Twitter. I'm going to start with at Matthew Picknett. Sorry if I butcher anybody's names. It's not my forte. Okay. Wants to know, with the news of Hamill himself, at Hamill himself, so Mark mm-hmm. Hamill, will you have any screen time together? So for anybody who doesn't know what's going on, this is somebody who in the old version of The Flash played Trickster mm-hmm. and is coming back to reprise the role. And,
so cool.
Which is really amazing that they've been doing that on the show. But they want to know if you have any screen time together. I'm not sure if you know the answer.
To be totally honest, I don't. We don't get the scripts that far in advance. Like, we're shooting 114 right now, 115 starts next week, and I just read 116 on Friday, and I don't think Mark comes until episode 17 or 18, so I haven't read that one yet, so I don't know.
But you would hope to have some screen time?
Yeah, absolutely.
I feel like you have screen time with everyone, though. You're an essential part of the Scooby Gang.
Caitlin gets around, that's for sure.
Okay, Jeff, you want to...
Unicorn ships.
At Unicorn ships.
I want to know... Since Danielle used to work in tons of horror films, would you like to guest on Supernatural?
Well, that would be fun. We're pushing for you on other shows already.
I mean, it was great being on Arrow. Supernatural does shoot in Vancouver, but, you know, I love being on our show. I love The Flash. I'm biased.
Very PC.
Mm-hmm. Love that answer. Okay, so this is from Purple Monkey at Monkshi1 wants to know, who inspires you as an actor slash artist?
Oh my gosh. I mean, we're sort of coming into award season, so it's amazing to see so many incredible artists. I was looking recently at Reese Witherspoon. You know, she's amazing. The best, and I'm reading Wild right now, and so I can't wait to see that. And she's had such a diverse career. I mean, Amy Adams, I love and respect, and I think she's so classy. I really love Jessica Chastain's work, too. You know, and Jessica Chastain is, like, having this incredible moment where she gets to work with so many incredible directors. So
a massive year for her.
Yeah.
Huge.
Yeah. I love Wild so much.
You read the book?
It's one of my favorites.
Oh, I just started it. I'm reading on the plane tonight. Yeah.
Jeffrey does a podcast about books, too, so he's a great reader.
Book Circle Online.
That's awesome.
Yeah, it's fun.
I just got into... This Is Where I Leave You, who's Jonathan Tropper.
Yeah.
I, like, read three of his books in a week.
Oh, really?
Because I always want to read the book before I see the movie. So I was trying to read This Is Where I Leave You before I saw the movie.
Did you see the movie?
No.
Okay.
it's
I loved
good.
The book.
See, I don't like to read it before the movie because then I'm thinking, oh, they combined those characters and that scene wasn't there.
Oh.
Okay, know. Coming back to our Twitter question.
Sorry.
No, don't be sorry. It's a good moment.
Suzette 11233 wants to know about the casting process, but we covered that, I think. Anything else you didn't share with us?
It was, again, super fast. Like, went in and met them on a Tuesday, and then, you know, had the big network, all that stuff happened on Friday, at the same time as Rick, actually.
Cosnet, yeah.
And then Friday night, we knew.
That's not supposed to happen that fast.
It never, ever, like, in my experience, has never, ever happened that fast. Which is, like, to me, a symbol that it, you know.
And lots of, like veterans working on the show with, like, Berlanti and David Nutter and Dave Rappaport. Like,
shout out to David Rappaport, our man.
He's the best.
Yeah, he came in for an interview here, too, and he's the most incredible. And he talks so highly about the cast of the show. So we knew that it was going to be a bunch of winners.
We're very lucky. I mean, truthfully, we have such a fun set. We goof off quite a bit in between, but like it's
sounds like you're dancing in between.
It is, like, there's so much dancing, and, you know, even on Friday night when we know we're gonna be there forever, as Grant said, he was like, well, at least we like each other, like, you know. We're happy to be around each other.
A party in itself on Friday nights. Okay, last Twitter question from Emmanuel Dominguez at EDM702000.
Okay.
Wants to know, as an actress, how do you prepare yourself in a romantic scene? So I think that's for a lot of upcoming scenes you might be having, whether they're with Barry or your fiance.
You know, the romantic scenes, truthfully, I feel like we can take Robbie, for example, because I've had some scenes with him. Like, I just adore him as a person, and we have,
You adore.
Yeah, Robbie.
Robbie Mel.
Robbie, who plays Ronnie, which is super confusing. Last week on set, I was like, Robbie! Ronnie!
And even more confusing, because then you've got Steven, and you can't call him by the last name.
I know, it's bad.
They're trying to mess with you.
It's true, they're out to get me. But in terms of the romantic scenes, you know, it's just about connecting with them on a human level, and, you know, I don't know. Hopefully not overthinking it too much.
It doesn't look like you're overthinking it. It looks like you're doing the perfect amount of thinking.
Thank you.
So we're wrapping up here, and we just have to tickle torture you one last time to find out, is there any other predictions or things that you can let us know about the show? What's coming up in tomorrow's episode?
Tomorrow's episode's going to be awesome. I mean, it's when Caitlin finds out what we as an audience know, that Ronnie is not dead, but he's also not himself. So it's a really cool journey as we figure out what's actually going on with him, and Caitlin tries to find out more about what's been going on with him. And that will carry us through quite a few episodes. You know, it'll be really fun starting like Valentine's Day next year. There's going to be a lot of romantic stuff happening. Cool. So it'll be good.
If your fans are missing you over the holidays and they really want to talk to you via social media, where can they find you?
Twitter at DPanabaker and Instagram at DPanabaker. And Facebook, I think, is Danielle Panabaker.
And Jeffrey Masters.
So good at social media.
No, you are. You're amazing. You're killing it. You're all over the ship wars.
Oh,
no.
Where can we find you, though, Jeffrey?
I tweet from Jeff Masters 1.
And you can find me at Roxy Striar. You can find us at AfterBuzz TV, AfterBuzzTV.com, or you can find us watching The Flash and talking about it on Tuesday nights at 9 p.m. Thank you so much one more time,
pleasure.
Danielle, for coming
Thank
in.
You.
You were amazing. We love you on the show.
Thank
we love
you so
the
much.
Show. And congratulations to you.
Thanks.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.